Welcome to the debate. Today, we are diving right into the bedrock of macroeconomic analysis, the consumption function. For anyone tracking aggregate demand, the private consumption function, C, is, well, it's where every analysis really begins. And the tension that comes out of the source material is, I think, simple but profound. When we're modeling C, how structurally complete does that function actually need to be?
Exactly. I mean, we're debating what variables are absolutely essential to define consumer behavior. Does private consumption rely, purely on the level of disposable income, YD, like in the foundational Keynesian formula? Or, and this is my point, does intellectual rigor demand that we include the market interest rate, R, as an equally indispensable variable?
And I'll argue that for the purpose of establishing structural stability and really understanding things like macroeconomic multipliers, the priority has to remain on that direct, powerful link between income and spending. We have to center our analysis on the function where consumption is a strict function of disposable income. It just offers clarity and tractability.
And I'm going to contend that the decision to consume now versus save for later is, it's fundamentally an allocative choice, and it's governed by the price of money, the interest rate. Any model that just ignores R is, I think, structurally blind to the main mechanism that partitions income, which makes it insufficient for understanding real-world dynamics.
All right, let's make our positions explicit. My position is really rooted in the overwhelming evidence that income is the dominant driver of household spending. I mean, if a household gets an extra dollar, the vast majority of studies confirm that a stable, predictable fraction of that dollar is spent almost immediately. That is the core insight of the Keynesian consumption function. So we model this as C being equal to a fixed amount of necessary baseline spending, what we call autonomous consumption, plus a proportion of disposable income. This autonomous consumption, it represents the spending that happens regardless of your immediate paycheck. You know, essentials like food, rent, basic utilities. It's what you consume even if your income momentarily drops to zero, probably financed by savings or borrowing. But the real power, the genius of it, lies in the marginal propensity to consume, the MPC. This coefficient tells us that for every new dollar of disposable income, which, you know, we calculate simply as total output minus net taxes, only a fraction, maybe 80 or 90 cents, is consumed. And crucially, the MPC has to be greater than zero, but less than one. This constraint is, it's the structural foundation of macroeconomics. It ensures that economic shocks dampen over time, and it forms the basis for the multiplier effect. By isolating YD, we isolate this critical stable behavioral coefficient. Moving away from YD as the sole variable just risks obscuring this primary mechanism.
The stability of the MPC is, sure, it's undeniable. But I think stability in isolation can be misleading. While I fully acknowledge the relationship between disposable income and spending sets the limit of consumption, relying only on YD produces a model that is, well, it's robust in its structure, but weak in explaining behavior, especially in a dynamic financial environment. Disposable income is simply the income available to households. But what do households do with it? They either consume it or they save it. That's the economic identity. YD equals consumption plus personal savings. So when you define consumption that way, as the residual of income after savings, you realize you have to understand the factors that govern savings, S. And this is where the interest rate, R, becomes indispensable. The interest rate is the reward for delaying consumption. It's the price of allocating capital across time. A high R fundamentally alters the calculation for every household. The incentive to forgo consumption and increase personal savings becomes, frankly, overwhelming. And this means that a rise in R causes a direct reduction in current private consumption, even if disposable income hasn't changed at all. The source material itself hints at this limitation, stressing that a comprehensive analysis must eventually include R. If we want a model that acts as a tool for policymakers, especially central bankers who primarily move R to manage aggregate demand, that tool has to explicitly include the lever being pulled. Excluding R just means our function is inert to monetary policy, which you get as a descriptive snapshot, not a predictive engine.
I understand your concern for behavioral accuracy, but let's go back to the utility of the model. For the purpose of establishing how shocks propagate through the economy, the simple linear function provides, I think, superior analytic clarity. It isolates the primary driver, YD, and it gives us that structurally critical term, the MPC. This allows us to calculate the fiscal multiplier, how much GDP changes from a change in government spending or taxes. If we bury the MPC within some complex multivariable function that includes R, we risk making the central mechanism of the income expenditure model completely opaque.
But that sounds like prioritizing mathematical elegance over economic reality. My concern isn't about complexity, it's about a failure to predict. If the central bank, trying to cool an overheated economy, hikes the rate R by, say, 150 basis points, and your model, C equals F of YD, predicts only a minimal change in consumption because income hasn't fallen yet, you fundamentally failed your forecasting mandate.
But the primary impact of R is felt through investment and asset markets first. Its impact on consumption is often delayed. It's indirect. It filters through wealth effects or changes in the capital structure, which might ultimately affect employment and therefore YD. The MPC, however, that's the stable parameter that immediately translates changes in employment and wages into spending. We have to build our foundation on the strongest, most stable behavioral coefficient we have, and that is the MPC determined by income.
I disagree entirely that the impact of R on consumption is delayed or indirect. I think it's immediate and direct, because it impacts the opportunity cost of holding or spending cash. When the interest rate on savings accounts or short-term T-bills jumps, households, particularly those with marginal disposable income, they immediately adjust their allocation strategy. They don't wait for a change in their paycheck. They seize the higher return on saving. This is just basic intertemporal choice. A model that ignores this active behavioral substitution is deficient. If R rises, C must fall. Your model can't explicitly capture this unless R is included.
But if we include R, we risk making the MPC itself unstable. If the interest rate dramatically shifts the proportion of new income that's saved, then the MPC, the slope, is no longer a constant, and that complicates the multiplier calculation severely. The genius of the Keynesian function is its stability. We rely on that stability. We need a model that describes stability first, and then we can layer on variables like R for a secondary analysis.
So you're arguing that we should simplify the model until it fits the assumption of a stable MPC. I would argue that the MPC is stable, but the level of consumption, the absolute C value for any given YD, is dramatically influenced by R. And if R fundamentally determines the starting point of the consumption curve, it has to be in the function. Consider a major fiscal policy action, like a tax cut that increases YD. Your model predicts a huge increase in consumption.
Right.
But if that tax cut coincides with a sharp rise in R, the behavioral incentive to save dampens the impact of that tax cut significantly. Your simple model will overpredict the fiscal stimulus. This shows that R isn't secondary, it's the critical modulator. Let's just look more closely at the identity. YD equals C plus SB. Consumption is logically defined as the residual. C equals YD minus SP. You focus so intensely on how YD changes, but C can't be understood without understanding how SP behaves. And when we look at real-world data, the determination of personal savings, SP, is overwhelmingly responsive to the rate of return, R. So if the interest rate dictates the savings portion, and the savings portion directly determines the consumption portion, then R is an inherent driver of C. It's not some exogenous shock to the system, it's the endogenous price mechanism that allocates available income.
To suggest that we can accurately model consumption without modeling the price of saving it's like modeling supply and demand without including the market price. It just feels conceptually flawed. I acknowledge the logic of C being the residual of savings. However, the consumption function we're debating isn't C equals YD minus SP. It's a behavioral function, C equals F of YD. That function holds because the MPC is a deeply ingrained behavioral habit. People consume a fraction of their income regardless of minor interest rate fluctuations, particularly in the short run. Most consumers, if they get a $500 increase in YD, they don't calculate the exact opportunity cost based on the current rate before deciding to buy a new household item. They simply spend the fraction they habitually spend.
The real strength of the pure C equals F of YD model is its ability to separate that short-run behavioral response, the MPC, from long-run structural shifts. The interest rate is absolutely crucial for the long run. It influences wealth, capital formation, the whole capital market.
But for short-run immediate analysis of income shocks, the YD model isolates the robust spending habit that governs aggregate demand.
I'm sorry, but I just don't buy that behavioral stability justifies exclusion. You're asking us to assume consumers are myopic or irrational, ignoring the explicit price signal attached to their income. A model based on the idea that consumers ignore the price of money is inherently limited, regardless of how stable the MPC seems. And let's address autonomous consumption, the C autonomous. You correctly state this is the baseline consumption that occurs even at zero income, but where does the funding for this baseline come from? It often comes from borrowing or drawing down savings. And if R is the cost of borrowing and the return on saving, it directly influences the consumer's ability and willingness to access those funds. A high interest rate makes borrowing more expensive, which reduces the feasible level of C autonomous. So R doesn't just modulate the marginal spending from new income, it affects the entire foundation of baseline consumption, causing the whole function to shift vertically.
Okay, that's a fair point. I agree that R influences that shift. But let's be precise. By using the pure Keynesian model, we acknowledge that the autonomous component, C autonomous, acts as a sort of residual component, capturing all non-income factors. We can then, in a second step, analyze how policy or structural changes, like movements in R or consumer confidence, affect the magnitude of C autonomous. But that doesn't require incorporating R directly into the foundational function itself. If we include R, we're suggesting it acts like YD, moving consumption along the curve. If it only shifts the curve by influencing C autonomous, then it's a structural factor, not a core functional variable like disposable income. That feels like a distinction without a difference when it comes to predicting aggregate demand. If a variable causes a massive, predictable, and measurable shift in the entire function, it has to be included in the function for predictive utility.
If the C function shifts down because high interest rates incentivize saving, that reduction in aggregate demand is significant. To rely on the simple model and then try to adjust C autonomous manually it's just inefficient. We need a function that mathematically guarantees the negative relationship. C is a negative function of R. This ensures that when R rises, the model automatically reduces predicted consumption for every single level of YD, and that's precisely what the comprehensive function C equals F of YD and R achieves. But my central defense of the simple model is its direct link to fiscal policy. When governments increase spending or cut taxes to manage demand, the mechanism operates almost entirely through YD and the MPC. The simplicity of C equals F of YD perfectly models the effectiveness of fiscal stimulus and the resulting multiplier. By forcing R in, you are prioritizing monetary policy implications over fiscal policy implications in the foundational structure.
I think I'm prioritizing the reality that monetary and fiscal policy do not happen in isolation. If fiscal stimulus is enacted, boosting YD, but the central bank simultaneously uses high interest rates to counteract inflation, increasing R, and saving incentives, we need a model that captures the resulting tug of war. The pure C equals F of YD model will erroneously suggest robust GDP growth, while the C equals F of YD R model will correctly predict a dampened effect because of high saving rates. Predictive utility has to trump structural simplicity. Let's consider the pedagogical value. When we introduce macroeconomics, we start with the pure income expenditure model precisely because C equals F of YD demonstrates causality so clearly. Income drives spending. That clarity is essential for understanding concepts like the paradox of thrift, which relies entirely on the stability of the MPC.
If we immediately introduce the complexity of R, we obscure the primary income-driven feedback loop that governs short-run equilibrium. The simple model provides a robust framework that's, universally applicable and easily testable. The pedagogical value is undeniable, but we are debating the most effective tool for expert analysis. The source material itself recognizes that sophisticated analysis must move beyond that initial framework. And the choice of consumption function isn't merely academic. It dictates how we manage economic cycles. If we prioritize the C equals F of YD model, we imply that the only way to reliably control consumption is through fiscal means, taxes and transfers.
If we accept C equals F of y dr, we explicitly recognize that the central bank, through monetary policy, has a direct, potent lever on aggregate demand by manipulating the saving incentive.
If our model is structurally blind to that lever, we handicap half of our policy toolkit analysis. The comprehensive function provides a necessary bridge between fiscal and monetary policy analysis within the household sector.
Empirical evidence often suggests that household consumption reacts quite, well, inelastically to interest rate movements, especially when you compare it to investment. It takes large, sustained shifts in R to meaningfully impact aggregate household consumption, whereas even minor changes in tax policy or employment immediately filter into YD and trigger the MPC. Therefore, the effect of YD is dominant and it's instantaneous in the aggregate.
And while I agree that investment is highly rate sensitive, we can't just dismiss the cumulative effect of R on consumption. Even if the immediate elasticity is low, the persistent signal of a high return on savings dictates long-term planning, refinancing decisions, large durable goods purchases, which collectively form a huge part of C. If we're modeling the economy, we have to account for all significant predictable forces acting on a variable. R is a highly significant predictable force acting on the division of disposable income. It belongs in the core function.
This discussion really reveals the inherent tension in economic modeling between parsimony and completeness. My position maintains that the fundamental macroeconomic behavior, that structural reliance of consumption on disposable income captured by the stable MPC, is the most crucial element to isolate. The foundational structure of the consumption function must therefore remain centered on YD. It provides the clarity needed to understand fiscal stimulus and the multiplier process.
And I conclude that while YD sets the budget constraint, the dynamic partitioning of that income into consumption and personal savings is explicitly and powerfully controlled by the interest rate R. Since consumption is fundamentally determined by what is not saved, and R dictates saving behavior, any function designed to capture true consumption dynamics, particularly for policy forecasting, must include R to account for this critical allocative incentive. Excluding it provides a stable measure of potential consumption, perhaps, but a deficient model of actual consumption behavior under real market conditions.
So the decision of which model to use ultimately depends on the question being asked. Are we studying the propagation of an income shock, or are we studying the effectiveness of monetary intervention?
Well, the more robust model should be able to handle both simultaneously. Understanding private consumption requires appreciating both the primary influence of income and the critical dynamic modifying role of interest rates on the fundamental decision to save.